Hello to all of you guys in the audience. I see a ton of people saying hi, saw me somewhere, heard something. Well, great news. I'm excited that I'm here now to kind of start sharing about something different. So if you've heard my talks, I talk about a lot of things from marketing strategy to deliverability to different things. But something that I hold near and dear to my heart that you'll see come through in this company, come in my past companies, is that I really am all about developing a lot of brand awareness and using that brand to actually leverage an email and SMS. So today we're going to give you what I call my 5 steps of developing brand awareness using email and SMS marketing in 2023. All right. So let's start off with me. Who am I? I'm Jimmy Kim. I'm here from sunny San Diego, California. Not so sunny today, but it's usually sunny. I think we got a little bit of June gloom happening over here. But what about me makes me important enough to listen to me? Well, first things first, I've been a digital marketer since 2009. So what is that? 14 years now in the making of being a digital marketer. Though I specialize in email, I'm very much a generalist in that I've seen a little bit of everything and worked a little bit of everything and went across from direct to consumer to SaaS. So I've seen both sides of that story too, which has been an interesting debate lately as well. I'm a former retailer. As Amir kind of mentioned, we were a brick and mortar. We actually started when I invested in this company. I took ownership of the company. It was a complete brick and mortar. The first thing we did was we turned it to a Shopify store. And over the years, we grew and it became a full on e-commerce direct to consumer store. I talk about that a lot on Twitter, actually. Last but not least, why all this brewed up to me becoming the CEO and co-founder of Sendlane. We're a unified email and SMS marketing automation platform for e-commerce. And that's what I do today. All right. So let's go ahead and jump into this presentation. So I've got this little box here. I have no idea what's going to pop up here because I forgot, but I assume that it's going to be all about the change of what brand is. And that is exactly what I want to start with. So let's remember, in real life, IRL is not equal to digital. And what I mean about this is that, you know, as we look back over the last couple of years and we look at how COVID has changed, the pandemic has really changed the way that people's buying behaviors changed. And then we went back. One of the things that we saw that happened quite often, and it still continues to happen, and something that we were challenged to figuring out is how do you create that great in real life retail experience but digitally, right? Everyone thinks about that, right? A human walks through your store, and a lot of people thought about this. A human walks through your store, you're kind of curating their journey, putting things in the back, putting things in the front, hiding it. Now on a website, it's completely different. Hiding things in the back would be the worst thing you could do in a digital website, right? So there's a lot of things that you got to think about when it comes down to it. In fact, when you think about the customer experience, that's what you're trying to drive here today. It's all about the certain handful of things. It's one, it's about building trust, right? Got to build trust with them. How do you build trust quickly? People are showing up to your website. You got 15 seconds to start building trust right away. And that can happen through words, images, and language. Evangelism and advocacy, right? When you think about customer experience, you don't give great customer experience just because you just want them to be happy. I mean, that's true. Of course you do. But the reality of why you give people great customer experience and why you want them to feel the trust and the belief in your business is because you want evangelism and advocacy. You want Joe Schmo, who came through your store and purchased something, to walk down the store, and when they see that little thing that you do, to be brought up as the first thing and just to say it. That human word of mouth is one of the most important pieces of things that you can have when you think about advocacy and having people who are able to talk about you. You're also trying to build a perceived value, right? Customer experience builds value. Everyone, you know, believes that things that are of better value that you perceive, right? If you see something, you get an inherent value from the experience that you have, you perceive that as a better value, right? There's loyalty that goes back to evangelism as advocacy, a little bit different. Word of mouth versus a repeat buyer, very different, but really loyalty and repeat purchasing is really number one on top of mind when you're thinking about retention marketing anyways. And then of course, it all ultimately helps you grow your business, right? That's really what you're looking to do here as well too. And then, of course, repeat sales. All right. So ultimately, what we talk about often is that, you know, as we're seeing this evolution happen, that your customer deserves more. In fact, treating the customers the way they want to be treated is exactly the future of customer experience. And that's really what we're going to be talking about here, is really how to drive that customer experience through email and SMS and all the things that you should be thinking about, the checklists, the frameworks, the thought processes behind all of it. In fact, a lot of playbooks are over 10, 15 years old. A lot of times the things that we do today and the way that we do a lot of our marketing today isn't evolving fast enough. In acquisition, they evolve super fast, lightning fast. But in retention, we evolve slower than a turtle. And in fact, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, when I was doing the same thing that I'm doing today, I see it often, that same playbook being utilized. So this is hopefully part of the step in your evolution, but really it's the focus of starting to create brand and characteristics. And I see a lot of brands starting to do this already. So this is going to be awesome. And I hope you enjoy that. So it's time to involve here. And so here's our agenda. So first we're going to go through the five steps of brand, building a brand. And we're going to go through that step by step. I'm going to talk about the three E's of great email. If anyone follows me on Twitter, for example, or on LinkedIn, you might see me talking about this. It's the formula that I believe that every great email has to have. It actually applies to SMS as well. I should update that and say great email and SMS. But I want to make sure that we go through that so you can walk away and think about how you should be writing those emails. And I'm going to go through some examples. We love case studies. Let's look at seven ways to write great emails that aren't what you probably think they are. And then let's not forget about the subject lines. And then I've got a little gift for everybody. All right. And of course, don't rapidly take notes and take screenshots of this. I've got the slides available for download at the end. Take the notes that you need. This will be recorded. You can get a download of it. And so I would love your undivided attention. And of course, I enjoy when you're conversing and chatting with me here on the stage on the side panel. So I do look over there often and make sure that I'm addressing the things I am. So thank you here for that. All right. So let's jump into how we build a brand. All right. It comes into five simple steps and we're going to break down each one of them. First, we're going to define your brand story and mission. Pretty straightforward. Second, we're going to talk about your personality, tone, voice, and content. Very different. Then we're going to talk about your templates and design. We're going to talk about the importance of your first message and what it really means. And last but not least, we talk about consistency is king or queen, whichever one you prefer. But this is how you build a brand in five steps for email and SMS. So let's jump right into the data. Let's jump right into the meat and potatoes of this presentation. All right. So step one, let's define your brand story and mission. All right. So brand story and mission is very simple. I like to break these down into three separate things. And here is a little snippet from a web page, but it's the exact thing. So let's talk about brand first, because I think that people often forget what the point of brand is. And people often just think about branding as what it is, just the logo, what it might be. But you know, the number one thing I say is when you're going through this exercise, you start defining your brand story mission. The first thing I ask you is, how do you want to be remembered? What I mean by that is when you're not in the room, right? When you're not in the room and people are talking about you, your brand is how you're remembered, right? You need to find your thing. Right? Your brand should have a thing. What are you known for? What are you good at? And what are others saying behind your back? Think about that. What do others say about your brand behind your back? Now, that is what brand ultimately is. It's not the way that your pink logo is shiny or it's got a great shadow or the rounded corners behind everything. It's how people perceive your brand behind your back and how people think this standout thing comes behind you and how people are able to look at that and say, man, that brand is X or Y or whatever, right? That's brand. That's something different than you should be thinking about. Not branding, but how people are thinking about your brand. Then it comes down to your story. And I know what everyone's thinking already, right? Story, man, I don't really have a story. Look, I always joke often about stories and it's hilarious, but these are still stories, right? Here's the thing. Sendlane.com, it's a perfect story I'm going to tell you right now, right? How did we come up with this great domain? Or, I mean, I don't know. I think it's great now, but I don't know if it's that great. But you know what? In 2013, 14, when we started this thing and created a domain for it, I'm going to tell you the honest answer. It was because it was $10.99. There was no other real reason behind the name. It was, hey, this wasn't a project to go forward facing. We didn't care. We just went to go buy a domain for $10.99. That's my story. And that's the truthful story around the domain, right? Nothing wrong with that. Find your story with that. So what is a real life story of the brand? It doesn't have to be about something like that. It can be about all sorts of different things. It could be about your story. My story is the fact that I was a D2C founder and I couldn't find what I needed to when we're thinking about be able to use for email and SMS. And I went and started to create something and I've got this big vision around unification and tired of the tech stack, but everyone has a story. So finding your story for your brand is just as important when you're finding it and making sure you can say it in 2-3 lines. There's nothing worse than telling a story that takes more time and effort than 2-3 lines. If you can't be quick and concise about your story is too long. And start finding that quick, tight story, all right? Stories about your customers. Story doesn't always have to be about your success. Let's say you've got nothing. You just sell a great product and there is no real great story. You just kind of started this business and there's no story around it. It just worked, right? Well, maybe your customers have great stories and their success stories. That can be your story too. Your stories don't have to be about yourself. Doesn't have to be about your brand. It can be about others as well, right? And same thing goes with mission, right? Mission is different. don't think about mission the same way I think everyone thinks about, right? Mission is not about who you give your stuff away to or who you inherit. It's who you stand for. That's your mission when you think about it. Why do you exist here today? It's making money is a reason to exist, just to be clear, right? But there's usually more to that, right? What do you stand for, right? What is your goal as the business? What do you want to do? Are you looking to be the number one guys? Are you just looking to create a great lifestyle business? Know that mission and share that with people because that is important to people. Some people like lifestyle businesses as opposed to people who are trying to build this big conglomerate, right? Whatever it might be. And who do you want to sell to? And ultimately, that's the biggest thing about the mission I look at. And people don't recognize how important it is to know that the mission is actually tying you to your brand, your story, and your audience just as much. If I want to sell to a certain demographic, I should stand for a mission that that demographic cares about. I shouldn't try to create or recreate a mission that they might not care about. It's much harder to create connection behind that as well too. All right. So moving on, we jump right into understanding your personality, your tone and voice, and your content. Let's talk about that a little bit more, right? Personality, tone, and content, voice and content. I mean, I know what you're thinking right now. Well, let's talk about it. Well, I'm going to break it down in simple layman's term again and really get you to start thinking about it. And don't worry, we're going to tie this all together towards the end here. So personality is very simple. Who are you? Who do you represent? What makes you memorable? Those three things are the most important things about your personality. Who are you? Who do you represent and what makes you memorable, right? That's your personality of anybody who comes up and wants to, you know, look at your product, right? Think about your brand. How do you create that brand within that, right? Who is the brand? Who does it represent and what makes that brand memorable? It's the same thing that we're just talking about on the branding side, right? And then it comes to this part. And this is the part that I think is the hardest part for most companies to achieve, but it's the thing that works. It's a thing that a lot of people will start talking about. This creates the most advocacy I've seen. It's really tone and voice. So shout out to the copywriters out there who enjoy copywriting, but look, what do you sound like? What should people expect of you? What words do you use? What words do you not use? Copy is inherently the most important thing because that personality and voice comes through the way that you've already represented. What's funny about brands often, especially digital brands, is very simple. Every one of your audience has a different thought process of what your voice might sound like, if that makes sense. They've got a voice in their head that goes, oh yeah, like that's a rad surfer dude, or like, hey, this is my mom, or like this person's like my old grandmother, whatever that voice is. We have a known contextual in our head based around all the things that we've seen, the way your colors are. It's human behavior to start driving this. So it's your job as the marketer or the founder or the owner to create that tone and voice that you want to inherently sound like the best you can, because you also have a sound in your voice in what you believe your brand should sound like in that tone and voice, right? So that's what you've got to think about. And then you come to the content. Let's talk about content because it is important just as much, right? Does it sound stand out? Is it exciting? Is your content unique and valuable? Is it relatable? Are you providing non-sales? Okay, so there's so much here, right? What I'm talking about with content is very simple. Look, and I'm going to be very clear here so that everyone understands. If you are a discount sales boutique and you put everything on sale and every month you want to sell and put things on sale all the time, not a problem. In that fact, you probably don't. Your content is your sales material that you're constantly putting out there. The people who subscribe to that list are people who want those sales. There was a great company that I don't think exists anymore, but it was Fry's Electronics. I used to love that store. I used to get spammed with their emails, which was just a giant advertorial of all the things that are on sale that week. And they would spam it out to me 6 times a week. And I was totally cool with receiving every one of them because that was their content they delivered to me. So when you think about content here, does it stand out? Your content unique? It's not about just coming up with cool content. I'm not telling you to go out and create vlogs or blogs or video content or audio or pictures. What I'm telling you is make sure your content is yours and who you want to be and who you want to represent. You want to talk about trees because you save trees, and you want to talk about blurb about trees all day? Make sure you put it on the bottom of it. You will create community and people who are interested in walking and talking about that, right? That's part of it. That's part of why content is important. So that's where I say, does you have content? One of my favorite and most favorite things, and I'll talk about this in a little bit more welcome thing, is create some non-sales bonus material. And what I'm talking about is how-to books, instructional videos, even if it's just a collection of your UGC of happy customers. Collect something together because people love non-sales bonus material, especially on that first welcome email. We'll talk about that more in a little bit. All right. So then we go into building your template and designs. All right. Here's another one that comes into place. And I see this so, so often, right? Everybody wants to create their best, best brands. And often we want to mimic the coolest brands in the world and the best brands in the world. These brands have billions of dollars and they don't really care as much about how much revenue they're making from their retention marketing. They don't care as much because their dollars and roll up are so significant that a lot of times we often try to copy that. So, you know, I talk about this and say, look, I get it. We all want to have that, but you've got to find balance. There's a balance between what a great brand and a great guide is and what conversions come into place. When you get to a certain size, 100%, you've got to be more and more. But let's talk about the things that you should have at least today, even getting started, regardless of what size you are. You're doing, you know, as you're growing and growing, everybody should have this. So let's go through it. Do you have a brand guide, right? That's your standard colors, buttons, images, fonts. And then do you have all the other things that are really important, right? Do you have a strong, defined CTA, right? Let's talk about that. Do you have a CTA that repeats on every email message, a thing that you chant, right? I have a client who likes to say, check out my deet, check out the deets, right? D-E-E-T-S, obviously Gen Z, younger audience. Check out the deets, click here, right? Does your design represent and create continuity to your website? Let's talk about that as well too. When they look at your email design, does it go from email to your website and does it flow through, right? Does your email look both good on desktop and mobile? Pretty obvious question there. And does it look like your other emails? That's probably the biggest point that I like to make sure. And I think people, again, forget how often this is important. Does your email look like other emails? Now, in a world where we're all talking about all the different strategies, quick tips, hacks, and different things, for example, I'll talk about one of them. One of the template designs we hear about is plain text or the direct response style, which is basically what it sounds like. Words on a screen with a blank link that's or a blue hyperlink on HTML link cloak over, very simple, raw looking. And of course, it absolutely works, right? 100% works. But why does it work? It doesn't work because it's more beautiful. And it doesn't work because it's just disruptive. It works because for the first time ever, in many cases when people are using this, they're actually using copywriting. It's giving a story, defining what they're trying to do and guiding people through, right? But is it better than a template or design? I don't think so, because if you can curate the same experience on an email, you're still going to curate a similar experience. The fact that you write so much on a direct response or a plain text email versus the so little that you create often on your sales email, a lot of times people don't give that fairness, right? So where I always say is if you're going to do that style, 100%, I'm a big advocate for it. I believe it works, but make sure it still looks like your other emails. What I mean by that is put the headers there. Put the same call to actions, use the same words, the colors, images throughout that email, just make it look plain text. So it's really something you've got to think about when you think about that, right? It's all about quality there. All right. And then we jump into the importance of this first message. You know, the first message is one that's so important. And most people, I don't know why, they don't pay attention as much as they should about that first message. So the first message, right? First, get it out there ASAP for every event. Anytime someone does something, they visit somewhere or they take an action, make sure you're out there, right? Everything should have a first message, immediate delivery, and so forth, right? I'm gonna kind of talk about this in a second, right? So you get it out there and you do it. And the first thing you're probably asking me is like, what should I send, right? Every time, right? So let's start off. Abandoned cart, I always tell these things, right? These are what I always tell on the three things that I tell about abandoned carts. Abandoned carts are great for reminding people, but it's also your opportunity to also get in front of them and try to get them to understand more about your brand and story. Imagine this, and I'm gonna use the retail idea, right? An abandoned cart is someone who walks to your store really quickly, opens the door, may browse a little bit, and then walks out without ever putting a product in, or maybe picking up a product but never coming up to the register officially, or even walking towards it, making a decision, whatever that might be, and they walk away. What would you do when they're walking away? Well, first, you can stop them with a pop-up and say, hey, 20% off if you still make that purchase, right? But the second thing you could also do, and the way you might think about it is as they're walking away, maybe there's more about the content about people wearing your clothes or people that are happy with your product or service, whatever that might be. So to me, an abandoned cart's really important because if you can get someone to kind of walk that journey with you and teach them about who you are, what your mission is, whatever that might be, because abandoned carts, they've already seen the product, they've added it, and you can remind them all you want. But using that space that you already have, to be able to try to get them and their mind changed. That's where I think it's really important that people miss the opportunity. It shouldn't just be focused on the product, but it should also have a hybrid. It can't be overly, you can't take away from the abandoned cart. You've just got to be able to supplement those well enough, right? And then you've got the new and repeat purchase people. Those are people that we absolutely should bring out. Now, here's my biggest tip when it comes to new and repeat purchases. Don't try to sell them something right away, the moment that they've just made a purchase with you. Please don't do that. Work on delivering that connection. That first message is a connection to retention, right? I know the goal is to create a repeat buying cycle, but ultimately find out a way where you can connect them with you even stronger and better. And that's why I was talking about instructions, UGC around how to use the product, UGC around other people and their happiness and their community and the mission that you have. The more you can engulf the person early with other information, when they're listening at the highest peak of them listening to your company and you can get them connected with you, that's going to create that long-term effect that you're looking for. Not the short-term effect of trying to sell them another 20% off. That actually just feels bad. When you make a purchase and the first email you get is 20% off their next purchase. That's actually a terrible feeling as a consumer as well too. So don't do that. Focus on making sure all of the things I've talked about with your branding and your story and your mission is coming out in that first message as fast as possible and is congruent to your website, right? And ask him to engage. I think this is going to be more and more that's going to start happening. There's a lot of ways to do this, but ask them what their favorite channel is. I think more and more I've noticed as I've watched and helped brands market is that brands are working on their, what's that called again? People have their favorite channels. The younger generation doesn't like email as much and they check email very infrequently. But when they like a brand, they want to engage with you a lot more, which is why SMS is pretty much important. So ask them to engage, throw a tag behind them, say, hey, how would you like to engage? You'd be shocked what you can get out of people when you ask them up front for their permission ultimately. All right. And then, of course, don't forget to automate it, having all your triggers. I'm not going to go through it, but making sure that you know that you're automating and making sure everything is there so that any action that they're making is 100% getting connected with. And then last but not least on step five is all about consistency, because this is another thing that we need to talk about. All right. So consistency is king or queen, whatever you want to say here. The theme is stay consistent, right? You are looking at consistency in a lot of ways. A, obviously all the things that we've just talked about, but really it's about this. I'm going to tell you this right here. The theme is stay consistent. We're talking about frequency, timing, center name, and call to action. I've already mentioned a couple of these throughout it. What I'm talking about is very simple. If you are creating a strategy around your email and your strategy is to email on Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays, stick to that. Then get down to the timing too. And your timing might be 4 p.m., 5 p.m., 3 p.m. Should try and test different things there. But ultimately, find out when the timing, when your audience responds the best and also converts the best using that timing, center name, and action. So getting consistent is important because you create expectations. If this brand sends me email at 6 a.m. every morning, and when I'm out reading the paper or having breakfast and I'm checking my email and I see this email all the time, I start to expect it over time. Humans are animals of behavior and consistency, right? So remember that, schedules. Other items, obviously, I say is like, obviously, make sure your templates, image, content, colors, fonts and colors and all that are all coming together as well, too. So that is number one. There's consistency. Got to make sure consistency is happening just as much, right? And so when you think about how this all rolls up, those five steps and how those all five steps roll up, it's really, really simple. One, brand story mission is how you feel. Think about this. I'm going to use this in human emotion here right now. Brand story mission is how you feel as a person. Then, or a brand. Personality, tone, voice, and content, that's how you sound. This is how they hear you, okay? So they felt you, they hear you, you're hitting human emotion first, then you're getting into the auditory emotion where they can hear you. The template and images, it's how you look. It's what they see. It's what they hear, right? Hear, sound, hear, feel, look, right? Look at that. The first message is how you seem, all right? Think about that, how you seem. What do you seem like? Well, that first message is the only actual communication I'm going to get, at least the one that I'm most likely going to see before the other ones start to fall off. This is how you seem like you're going to be. And then consistency is how they hear you. And what that means is very simple, how often they hear from you, how they hear you, how they look at you. Are you the friend that shows up on Christmas and Christmas and Black Friday? Or are you the friend that I want to listen to every day, right? How do they hear you, right? Think about that. So when I think about branding and customer experience, it's very simple. I think about it in the very much the tone that who that person is going to give that experience of feeling, sound, looks, you know, who you seem like and how they hear you, right? It touches on all those sensors. All right. So, and it all starts with the right message. Send the right right time to the right person. We've all heard this, right? What does that right message start with? Well, it starts with designing a great email. So, or SMS, right? So I'm going to explain to you what I call the three E's of a great email. All right. So body of a great email, and this works on the subject line. We're going to break down both sides of it because they're a little bit different in the thought process, but I want you to see and understand the mindset that I have when it's talked about great email. And a great email to me does one thing. It drives clicks. That's the focus of every email, in my opinion. Opens don't matter. Nothing matters except for the click, because without clicks, there's no revenue. All right. So excite. Number one and foremost, excite. Excitement. What makes them want to continue to read your email? Opening an email is based on a subject line, right? There's a high level of opening on that email. But when I talk about excitement, it's what keeps people going, all right, I need to know more. I need to know more. I've got live examples to break this down to show you this. We got educate. Educate is the logic of understanding and telling them what and why, right? The more educated the buyer, the more likely they're going to click, all right? Think about that. You need to educate them. You need to teach them why or what. Why should they look at it? And then to edify. The last E is edify. Ask. Don't be vague. Get really focused and ask for the click, right? Look, without a click, nothing matters when it comes to retention marketing. Yeah, you could say view and impressions and all that stuff, but let's be honest. The goal that we have in retention marketing is getting the click and make the purchase ultimately over time as fast as possible, right? So when you're writing a great email, it's the same thought process. You've got to make sure that A, I've got them excited. They're going to read my email because they want to learn more. And because they've asked me to click and it's so exciting, I'm going to click on, right? Edify. So let's jump into this a little bit deeper and look at seven examples with great branding and great emails. These are good examples that I think are really, really a great way to kind of look at it. All right. So first, we're going to look at this email from Bloom. All right. Take a look at this email, right? It's pretty interesting. There's a lot of things going on here. So I'm going to break them down. All right. This is product personalization. All right. So first thing's the excitement. Meltdown and Stargirl consider them the ultimate acne fighting duo. That's exciting. I don't have acne, but if I was 16 and I had acne, this would get me super excited, right? And then I go, all right, what's the education? Apply the meltdown to a blemished area. Spray Stargirl for a seriously nourishing effect, right? Look at and read that, right? It's education. It's teaching me exactly how it works right now. And it's educational, but it's still exciting. And then I've got to edify. Shop both and save. One, two, three. A great email. Take a look at that. So easy to understand. And it's not a lot of writing. It's not a lot of education here. It really is just having the right things. The three E's pop up. All right. Example two. Let's look at beard brand, right? To sell two products and one, right? First, I say this is your excitement because Jeff has his eyes on your reward, right? Ooh, that's exciting. What's going on? Why has Jeff got my eyes on that, right? We look at it and go, education, right? Don't forget, you can hang on, you know, use this beard softer. It's very obvious, evident. And then of course, the edification, use your code, SML, blah, 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 right? And then you got the shop products behind. But notice how they edified you by saying, use your code, right? It's a, if you notice in this email, which I really appreciate a lot, Jeff has his eyes on your rewards. Don't forget your well-deserved, right? Use your code, right? Notice that? What are they doing? They're talking. This is how they talk to you. And they're starting to show off their brand that they're here for you. And that's how you should feel. But you're still nailing the three E's. You see that? All right, next one. Here's an upsell subscription box from, I can't remember who this is from, but subscription coming up. I love this one. So simple too. Again, I want to show you all these examples because it's important to see how simple they can be. So there's your education, right? There's your excitement. Toss more in before we ship and you edify them. Such a simple thing, but they show up in every single email when you think about it. Here's another one. So this one is about a bundle. Right? So the men's demographic, we also know that men, and this, because I'm in this background, I know that we like similar niche colors and we like bundles, right? So the excitement is BYOB, build while you're bundle and save, right? Then all the education is everywhere. In fact, they did a great job of education versus visually and versus the words. So if you look at the visual, the words there, you see that they said build customized bundles and three mix and match or teaching everything, but they're also showing you through pictures. Here's three colors, here's three drop cuts, and their pricing is right there. And then of course you edify it right now with the shop now, right? Think about that. It's so soft. It's a soft sale. It doesn't feel aggressive at all. But man, if I love this brand, I'm excited because I might as well pick up some shirts for a discount because discounts are always nice to have, right? All right. So let's keep going. Feather. All right. I love another one. This is a total different one. And I love the urgency and timing they use on this one. So we're going to talk about this one a little bit. Feather has got excitement. Well, don't miss $300 off your first month. This is very much assuming you must be in the furniture market. You must have opted in for it. It's obvious that it's very focused, right? The excitement here is, though, don't miss $300 off. Very monetary excitement level, but it's very important. And it says use code, right? The education is very simple and straightforward, too. Take $300 off, yada, 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 right? Transform your space. Super simple. And then, of course, you've got the Edify here. Right? This one's a little softer, but it's showing that it can still be used within a framework at all times. And it's important that if every time you're looking one of your emails that you don't see this, then you probably are missing the boat somewhere along the way. Here's Bombas, right? Here again, let's talk about the ethical bribe, I call this one, right? So you're overloading value. You've got 20% off, free shipping, 4-pack variety. You've got all sorts of things going off on here. But let's go ahead and get right to it. Excitement, right? The excitement is super simple. I'm assuming that this is a pop-up opt-in email, right? The excitement is super simple. Notice how small they kept that, I thought was really interesting. And because to me, I think that they were really focusing on getting more people that haven't purchased to purchase, right? But they didn't lead with that hero message where often we might say, get 20% off your first order and make it a big email. What they did was they focused on the other things that are almost add-ons. Not only 20% off, free shipping and returns for $50 and more. Plus, there's all these bundles here. So you go through it and you go, wow, the education is actually below the fold. And the edification, in my opinion, is about the free shipping. It's that simple. I would click on that right there. I would have put a little button right there to learn more somewhere right above there because that would have been a powerful email. All right. Here's Thrive Market. Here's another one. I call this the free gift order. I love this because right after the first order, they didn't try to sell you the traditional way where they're just giving you a 20% off coupon. They're offering you ability to claim a free order bump, and it costs you nothing to get this product. It's completely free. All right. First order 24. But by the way, while you're in there, we'll probably see some upsells and products that you can sell. So excitement, get your free product, get your free gift. The edification is very simple. Choose and scroll and pick. And then of course the education is below. Again, this is graphical education. I love to see here is that they just put a bunch of products that don't really truly relate perfectly to each other, next to each other, to show that you have a lot of options. That's the education I get from this. And also below here, it starts to break down each one of those gifts. If you would have gone down the image, you would have started to see the breakdown of each one and knowing that Chomps, grass-fed beef sacks were obviously a great option to pick as a gift right now because you are now getting a new exclusive new member perk right now for my best-selling orders, right? For my first order that I just made. Awesome way of being able to do it. So again, effective, super clean, easy way to see it. Still stays on brand. You can feel the brand theming color on every one of these emails. All right. But let's not forget the subject line, guys. Subject lines are just as important. So we're going to talk about it. In fact, 33% people open it, not open rates. I'm not saying people are going to have open rates. 33% of people open your email because of this subject line. So number one, I say sell the sizzle, not the steak. Let's not sell it and give it all away, right? When you think about, and why I just learned a really horrible thing from TikTok recently that that Mexican restaurants, you know that like when you get the fajita and you get the steak and you get the chicken and you get the steam coming up, learned something horrible on TikTok recently where I found out they just use water or oil or something and make it artificial. It doesn't actually look like that coming out of the kitchen. Very bummed by that. But usually I use that. I use that analogy because that's my favorite analogy when you think about it, right? When they do put that water into that little thing and they make it sizzle and walk through the restaurant, what do they think? You hear the sizzle first, you hear it making that noise, then you start smelling the steak and the chicken, the deliciousness, and then last, you see the fajitas, right? That's selling a sizzle, but not the steak. Think about that, all right? So excite, right? We're gonna break it down for subject lines. Excite, strong attention grabbing words. Educate, what is it in the email that they need? Think about that, all right? And then edify, why should they open this email, all right? We're changing the thought process a little bit, but it's not that different from the formula that I just showed you. Excitement is strong attention grabbing words. Excite, what is it the email that they, why should they, why, right? It's gotta be quick, 20% off, 50% off, free things, new shoes, whatever it is. and what should they open? All right. Well, let's jump through some examples real quick. I'm going to fly through these a little bit. I don't want to be too slow here, but I'm going to give you some examples, right? And they don't have to be super, super like crazy. I just want you to make sure you have all three elements of the E's in there. Introducing our new red shoes. How are you exciting them, right? Excitement here is new, the new red shoes that you're introducing, right? You're educating because it's obviously new, right? And then you're edifying him because you're saying, you're introducing the new red shoes, you better click on me. That's all inherent, but you better click on me to learn about those new shoes. It's all coming through as you can question yourself through that formula. Flash sale, 20% off, last chance. Whew, there's a lot in that one, right? The excitement is it's a flash sale. The education's 20% off. Last chance, that's your reason to edify. Must have shoes for this summer. You can do the same thing there, right? What, why, right? What's the reason that you should know? It's the must have thing. It's for this summer and shoes that I need. So I'm going to click on it. It's summertime, right? So it continues on. Find out why these red shoes are hot this summer. Get the red shoes today. Pay later. Today only, free shipping and 20% off. Meet our best red shoes plus free shipping, 20% off your Sunday shoe needs. I was really into shoes when I wrote this deck, apparently. But look, listen, and I don't own a pair of red shoes, but apparently I do need a pair of red shoes. But listen, as you read all of these subjects, they're not revolutionary. They're not something that are so hard, right, to for you to formulate ultimately. They're just all formulas. If you look at the three E's and say, can I get them excited? Can I get them educated? And can I get them to open this email because something is exciting? 1, 2, 3. If you can go ahead and uncheck those marks, then you can move them forward, right? That's really all a great open rate really entails is, I mean, not open rate, open action entails. It's someone getting so excited because you've done a good job telling them why. Now, you could argue with me, you can be ambiguous, you can be vague, you can do all these things, you can put emojis everywhere. 100%, you can. But I'm trying to give you a formula that's actually repeatable, one that doesn't have to come up with you finding some crazy clickbait each and every time, right? All right, and let's not forget the preview text. Something that I tell people all the time is that preview text is just as valuable as your subject line. And so it's important that you're going through and really making sure those subject lines are really brought to the table. Anytime I write a preview text, it's no different than one of these. It's my subject line two, I call it. I call it subject line one, subject line two. Often I do this as a test. I like to do what I least to do an AABBC or ABCD or some variation of that test. But often that test I like to do is really just going through and using my preheader and flipping it with my subject line and running small tests on almost every email. That small test, I know it sounds silly, but that small little test can tell you a lot about your audience. Like sometimes it's often I see a brand put in their save 20% off today, always in the pre-header and never on their subject. I said, hey, let's just test it real quick and flip it around and see what happens. Let's let the data tell us the story behind it. And we'll set up the data. And often you'll see that sometimes the brand just, they haven't been pushing the fact that it's a sale. They don't know it's a sale because the subject line was too boring. And you'll learn that sometimes as well too. So absolutely think about that when you think about it. All right, free gift, guys. I've got a little gift here. If you enjoyed some of the things that I talk about, it's a pretty long course. I think it's now 12-hour course. And the 12-hour course is really all about email, a little bit about SMS. It's about everything. But it's 100% free, just like everything else I give you. All you got to do is scan here and grab this course. It's me telling you about as simple as what a click is, all the way to talking about deliverability. We're going to talk about strategy. We're going to talk about MVC frameworking. We're going to talk about event planning. We're going to talk about all sorts of different things that are both low and advanced level trainings that I've had over my years of experience. I give this course away for you being able to come here and sit and listen to me for the last 40, 45 minutes or so and listening to me. So I thank you for that. And that's my free gift here. And last but not least, I have a bunch of little links here. And again, the only link that really matters here is probably downloading the slides here. Download the slides, get them at this link. I will get them posted in this get this in this chat room so you can see it. Madison will probably post this. So you can just click on and save it. You can follow me if you like what I'm talking about and enjoy me. I am on LinkedIn and I'm also on Twitter. My Twitter is Yo Jimmy Kim. My LinkedIn is obviously just Jimmy Kim, my name. I tweet often. I drop a lot of tidbits just like this all over it. So engage with me there. Questions, email me, jk@sendlane.com. And if you wonder where I got all these great email examples from, got them from a great website and a partner, really good emails.com, really cool place to check them out. So with that, thank you guys all for allowing me to be here and share, and I hope you learned something very cool.
Awesome talk as usual, Jimmy. Thank you so much.
We have a lot of questions, so we'll get through as many as we can. So I'm just going to jump right into it if you're good with that, Jimmy.
Cool.
Okay, let's see. Here, this is a, you were talking about sense of urgency. Don't companies lose credibility if they keep creating a sense of urgency every week?
The old sense of urgency. So here's the thing. Sense of urgency is done, you can do it classy and you can do it very, very dirty feeling, right? The dirty feeling is like last chance for this sale to ever happen. Last chance for this, last chance. It makes them feel that, right? I like to use a sense of urgency like hurry. Our sale ends at midnight. There's nothing wrong with giving that level of sense, urgency, right? But when you tell them this is the last time something's going to happen, when you make bold statements, right? Come up with ways to create urgency that are not bold, just to create time sense urgency that things are expiring and you don't know when they're going to go back on sale, right? Think about it a little bit different. So I would say that's how you should be kind of thinking about how urgency works in your business.
Cool. And we actually had multiple questions surrounding this next one, just about really email design. But this one from Adam, graphic heavy emails. We're doing a good job of these styles of emails and making them responsive can be really time consuming. Any tricks for making that faster?
Interesting. Well, if you're using all emails, images, well, that might be part of your challenge that you're always going to have, right? Why? I guess I ask always, right? What's your focus on your email? The one thing that I see, when I see a lot of branded heavy images, it's very simple for me. I'll tell you what it is. They have no focus. Go look at your email and see where your actual focus and what you're trying to accomplish out of the email. And look at where all the people are clicking throughout your email and take a look at that, right? That's probably step number one before I even start addressing the images part. The second part after that is probably starting to address the images. Why are there so many images? How can there be so many images if you're focused on a single CTA or focused on a single product or a service? If you've got a lot of products and services, you're probably doing yourself a disservice anyways, right? Now, that all ties into where it comes in images. Well, again, if you know some of the things I talk about often, I talk about the fact that images can actually cause you deliverability problems, right? There's a topic there, a whole separate topic to talk about. But more importantly, less about the deliverability, how are you getting the message across if it's just images? That's always my question that I have, right? How are you delivering it? Is it words inside the messages? If it is, start separating those words out of the message. And now you can kind of focus on the image. So there's a lot of ways to look at it. I think image heavy is hard, and trying to find that balance behind it with brand is a really tough exercise. I see it all the time. And what I tell people is very simple. I know that you want something of high caliber beauty and design each and every time. But consistency requires you to have a similar look in each and every time. When you have a similar look, often it's really hard to stand out every time just using images. Words and copy are going to be the thing that drives a different experience. So we see that with different brands I work with, you know, simplifying, making things easier for the marketer to do that doesn't require a designer. These are all positive things in what you'll probably end up. And at the end of the day, look at your CTR. That's what matters most anyways.
And by the way, Adam, too, well, worth mentioning that as far as responsive, you can use frameworks like mjml.io that does require some knowledge and ability. Sendlane, I'm not a plug here, but it is important to note, Sendlane's email builder actually generates mjml code versus like HTML5, which is truly a responsive framework, cuts a lot of work in half, man. So mjml.io is the framework. Sendlane's already doing that out of the box in the email builder.
And there are a couple of people that commented just on like not being good at designing even basic emails. Also, don't forget all the great resources out there. Like Once Upon a Time, I was using Fiverr for people to help me just build emails, whether you're doing an HTML email or building it in your builder. Like, don't forget some of those resources too, because not everybody can afford a graphic designer, as Mary mentioned, of course. Okay, let's see. We've got a lot in here. Okay, this is kind of a long one, but let's dive into it. Jessica says, our emails are so much more text-based. We use a footer, but a standard email look, not blocks of color or tons of images, mainly because we're sharing educational, conversational value emails, not just products. Is there a reason to not do emails like ours?
No, there's no reason. Yeah, it's your brand. It's how you want to perceive. If you're an educational forefront and you've got a lot of conversation and words, that's just how you guys sell. There's nothing wrong with it. I think when I talked about earlier, it's more about how you're disrupting your patterns often and over-disrupting sometimes as well too, with using plain text when they're not often using plain text. So a little bit different, but similar idea for sure.
All right, let's see. Here's a good one. Would you craft different stories depending on the stage of your company or the clients that you are targeting?
Well, obviously you should be, when you think about it, it's very simple, right? You have an ICP of like who your customer, ideal customer looks like and what you're looking for in targeting him. I don't think your story changes. It just adds on and evolves as you start hearing back from people and hearing the things that are important to them. You expand on that story, but I don't think it crafts different stories. I think it crafts that. Now, as far as positioning, that's a whole different story. If you're talking about like what your unique value in the market is and how you position yourself, that obviously crafts as your business evolves too. So that's a little bit, not sure exactly what side you're talking about there.
Okay, this one actually sparked my personal interest. Jessica said, we had a copywriter who had the voice down perfectly and replacing her was a little rough transition before the new person really embodied our brand. I was gonna just jump in here and say, Jessica, if you can take the time to just write up what your brand voice is with examples of things, like we have to have that at Sendlane, we have a lot of writers. Like if you can really just define that, obviously it takes people time to adapt it, but I think it's really important to put it in writing. Like who is your brand? When they're writing, who are they as a person? And I'm sure like Jimmy has feedback on that, but that's very brand guidelines and voice and tone are just very near and dear to my heart.
Yeah. Often I see a lot of brand founders often still write their own emails often because of that or have to approve their own emails. I know a 30-some million-dollar brand, he still writes all his own emails because he wants that tone and voice to come through. So I think it's all about how important is that tone and voice in the market? Is it that unique? And if it is that unique, it's sometimes hard to pass it on, but it sounds like you figured it out eventually. And sometimes it is tough, right? I 100% agree with you on that.
All right, I'm going to put one more up on here with the very popular topic of ChatGPT. What are your thoughts on using ChatGPT for subject lines?
I'm not going to really talk about it too much because it's actually something we're going to talk about tomorrow at my fireside chat at 11, I think it's 11:15 or 11. What time is it tomorrow? Let's see here. 10:10. Wait.
What time? Hold on. I'll tell you.
11 a.m. tomorrow. 11 a.m. PST tomorrow. Yeah. So 2 p.m. Eastern. Chase Diamond and myself are literally going to talk exactly about ChatGPT, OpenAI, everything, right? AI, email, the future of it. We're going to talk about deliverability, inboxes. We're going to talk about how we utilize it. And Chase is going to actually show you guys how he uses it within his businesses and clients a little bit as well, too. We're going to talk about that. And we're going to talk about all that. So I don't want to spoil the fun because we got a lot to talk about. And this is my tease to say you should be there tomorrow at 11 o'clock.
Love it. All right. Thanks, Jimmy. We will we'll see you tomorrow. Thanks for a great talk, as always. And be sure to catch Jimmy and Chase tomorrow, 11 a.m. PST, talking about all things AI.
Yeah. Awesome. And if you didn't get a chance to get your questions answered, I definitely encourage you to reach out to Jimmy, communicate with Jimmy. He's very active in social media and kind of a big deal in Twitter. So hit him up.
Cool. Thank you, guys. See you guys later. Have a great show, everyone.
Thank you.
Great talk. Great awesome, topic.
As always. Yeah.
Right.
Do we have next? I think we have Triple Whale next.
Yes, we do. But we have more important things.
Right.
Current moment to discuss. Those things being.
Boom. Money. Well.
It's prize time.
It's prize.
I was really not ready with my like 90s throwbacks, guys. I'm stressed out. I'm looking for a 90s. Oh, wait, here we go.
Anybody catch my Flight of the Conchords referral? No? Okay. That's kind of 90s. Lauren, I like some mace. We're going to use some mace.
All right. let's jump right into this prize. We are giving away. See what our prize is.
Apple Watch. Ooh, nice.
Apple Watch. And yes, because people ask this, it's a big concern. We will let you choose the color that you want. Okay. Don't panic. If you are the winner, we'll make sure that you love your gift.
Yes.
All right. Amir, can you
give
me a little roll? And the winner is
Ryan Sorensen. Congrats, Ryan. Yeah. Am I the only
one? Yeah. Congratulations, Ryan, on your new Apple Watch. That's how we do it here at Commerce Roundtable.
That is how
really,
we do it.
Really is that. Like, that's just how it goes. We like to give stuff away because let's be real, we're all sitting here staring at a screen for hours. And yes, while we're
learning,
I didn't discredit the value of the learning, but like, it's nice to get free stuff while learning things.
It's a little bit of a nice coating of frosting on your cake.
Yes, a nice little frosting, if you will. Yes. There is a poll in the chat.
Nice.
That Madison has posted. We want to know, have you been here? Are you a first timer? Are you returning? We want to know, like, those of you who've been here and those of you who it's your first time around, we want to know.
Yeah. I want to know who's been here for two or three times or more.
And we have a game coming up.
We
love our memes here. We love the memes. So we have a little game coming up. Do not do your captions now. Wait till session two. Submit them in the next session. This is our meme. We've got a very... Is that Kate Hudson?
I don't know who it is, but she's having a time.
No,
she's...
it can't be.
It's the
like reality TV. Somebody tell me who this is because the girls on my team picked this.
But it's usually accompanied with that like cat. It's like her and that cat. Usually.
I'm aging myself right now, not knowing this. I feel like someone's gonna tell. Thank you, Sharice, Housewives.
Thanks, Sharice.
See, I'm an old lady. My team is like, gosh, Caitlin, you're embarrassing us right now. Anyways, here's the meme. You're gonna caption this with the e-commerce caption. We're going to choose a winner. We do not choose the winner, by the way. Our team behind the scenes choosing the winner. We're just here to read the names. Get creative, make it e-commerce focused. Nothing dirty, nothing inappropriate. It can toe the line, though. We accept towing the line.
Yeah.
We're going to submit that in session two, and that is how you potentially win the next prize. So with that, we're going to go get Mia from Triple Whale ready to rock. So we'll see you over there.
See you guys.